for you, but I also just want to say thank you so much for coming. Enjoy. Come closer if you want to. The readers will appreciate you masking up when you're not drinking to just help us feel safe up here to speak, but you can come a little closer. And there are books at the back of the room for sale, open bar, QR codes. If you want to make a donation to the Seventh Wave for the work they're doing in the Seattle area and also in New York, it's a bi-coastal org, then please feel free to support. There are anthologies in the back for purchase, and just thank you. So I will call Ms. Joyce Chang. She has a few words for you, and then we'll kick it off with our beautiful readers. Let's see if this works. Can you see me, Joyce? Can you see me? Hello. Can you hear me? You're on speakerphone.
We wouldn't be the Seventh Wave without you. So just knowing that you're all in the room here together, about to witness some fucking incredible poetry with these seven poets just makes me so happy. I want to hug you all. I know that we are not in the same space, but we will be at some point very, very soon. And just one last thing I wanted to say, which is that we're launching our issue 16 in June, and along with that, we're going to be launching our brand new website, which is being developed by the brilliant Meg Sykes, who I know is also in the room today, so I just want to give her a huge shout-out. She's been working so damn hard to make that a reality, and, you know, I have the best time tonight. You all are my heart, and I'm so thankful that you're showing up. I always say for yourselves and for each other, and I know it's going to be such a special night. Sending you all a lot of love, and Patricia, I'll hand it back to you.
Thank you. Thank you, Joyce. We love you. Round of applause. Thank you. Thanks for tuning in on the live stream. All right. Well, with that, thank you again, and without further ado, I'm going to start kicking it off and let you know that tonight, as I intro our beautiful seven readers and I get to be a part of this gorgeous lineup, I'll share this cute thing that Joyce did, which was to encourage all of us readers to share a word about the person's work. So as I introduce Gabrielle Bates, I'll say that the words the readers came up with that describe her and her work were lush, profound, unflinching, and horn. And Gabriel Bates is the author of Judas Goat, Tin House 2023. If you haven't gotten a copy, you can get a copy of Judas Goat in the back here or from Gabby. And do they have copies? Oh, they don't have copies. There's open books not far away, and you can definitely get a copy there because you're out of copies, right? All right. Ruth Lillian, Dorothy Sargent Rosenberg Poetry Fellowship finalist. Poems have appeared in The New Yorker, the Academy of American Poets Poem a Day, Plowshares, among other journals and anthologies. Originally from Birmingham, Alabama, she currently lives in Seattle, where she helps out at Open Books, a poem emporium, which you should visit if you haven't yet, and co-hosts the podcast The Poet Salon. So welcome.
These poets, this space, and Seventh Wave are organizers and hosts. Seventh Wave as an arts org just approaches things with a level of care and thoughtfulness and thoroughness and creativity that feels incredibly rare to me and very beautiful. So it's a dream reading. Even if I wasn't on the lineup, I was telling Troy on the walk over here, I would be here attending because these are some of my favorite people and poets. So my book is a very haunted book. It's haunted by a lot of things. It's haunted by a kind of Southern Gothic disposition. It's haunted by a certain kind of religious authority. But more than maybe anything else, it's haunted by attachment and interdependence and the risks that desire necessitates. I'm going to read three poems from the book, and I'm going to start with a hometown poem because we have someone from Birmingham, Alabama in the audience today who I just got to meet for the first time. Shout out to Katie. This is called Strawberries. A car's tires thunk over the rubbery black tripwire at the oil change, triggering a fat bell. And a group of girls in silver leotards are reflected, like spatters of sap in its windows, liquidine, firm, gleaming. It's a game day. They are the girls chosen to split in tempo to the brass band, heel of a front foot sliding over astroturf, top of a back foot grinding over lit green, cervix slapping the 50-yard line like a fried egg flipped down on a griddle to burn. Behind the bleachers, a boy takes off the shirt of another boy, paints a letter there in red paint. R, and then another boy, I, O, T. When the sun goes down over the ridge, all the painted boys will make patriots. For now, the sun rises, sanctioning the street. Jiffy Lube, pet store, the Sam Super Sandwiches teens file into, practicing the joke of language. The morning is cool on the outside and hot in the restaurant. The war and the words, playful as a war can be, meaning each gut bleeds out like a slit pig's, filling the cracks in linoleum, spilling over, becoming smooth. The layers of red dry and build on one another. And for years, the gap between ceiling and floor lessens. Backs hunch as the mind saws downward, revealing rings. In the parking lot, are you asleep? Says the boy who is not my boyfriend, running his fingers along the band of my underwear. Across the street from this, for years, an ancient tortoise roams the floor of the pet store, closing his army green beak around the red toenails of sandaled women, thinking them strawberries. I feel ashamed for all the moments I've been kind, knowing kindness is all it would take. There are several people in this room who have been a part of a really sacred to me, at what was at one point a weekly writing workshop, like informal writing workshop, where miraculously, somehow, we gathered or found a way to exchange new drafts every single week, which still blows my mind. And it was so special. And I could not have written this book without Aaron Lynch, Aaron McCoy, and Patricia Humianek, for sure. And I remember, I wanted to read this poem, even though I rarely read it at readings, because I remember, like so many, I'm prone to these moments of intense despair about my work, and I think I'll never write a poem again, or at least never one that means anything to me. And I remember being in that state for a while, and then writing this draft, and my writing group was kind to me about it. So thank you. This is called Conversation with Mary. What language did the angel speak? My most private language. Was the angel fluent? Nuances were lost. Where did the angel come from? The ground. Did you consider yourself a woman or a child before this? Yes. And after? Yes. What was the tenor of your joy then? Choiceless. Did it hurt? Forever. Did you feel rewarded? I, hallelujah, I assented. How did it feel? Cold blood on the cock of God. Whose blood? My blood. I'm just gonna read one more. It's a little longer, and it's the final piece that I wrote for this book that allowed me to kind of close the container of the book. And it started out as a much longer and very different kind of piece, more of an essay, and then it became this longer poem called Mothers. When Bridget Pegeen Kelly writes about holding her daughter, I pretend this is my mother speaking. We are orphans together, running the red bridge from Japanese garden to British garden, hushed laughter until we reach the greenhouse on the slope, chests heaving, chased by the stepmother's cruel blue eyes. She reaches for me across the bed we share for the weekend. You're grinding your teeth. A translation occurring, in the case of worry, from compassion, woundable, to antagonism, wounding. My mother's eyes are also blue, but warmer, softened by greens. Algal blooms stitching blankets over unswum pools. Much has been lost, but not this. Outside of poems, our tones rarely match the core of what we are saying. How surely we are contained, writes Bridget Pegeen Kelly at the end of the beginning of her first book. How well our small boundaries love us. How well my mother gave birth to a boy. How well and long after that baby latched. And I saw it like a vision, the tragedy I'd asked for. I would be asked to raise him. And so I practiced boarding a bus, just the baby and me, dipping my finger into honey and nibbling it into his mouth. In the land of our foremothers roamed a spirit called Mamuna, who who rose at night from swamps to raid the closest bassinets. I often feel the love our boundaries have for us dooms, to some extent, the love we have for each other. But it also feels true to say a smallness can be stretched and our lights shined through. Bridget, who can't sleep when the moon is approaching fullness, through whom a private current glows, who describes her son as a scything soldier, her daughter as a hapless beauty, a ghost now singing through black-haired goats on the side of the road, slow water, and every small brown winging in the bushes, in the bramble. Is it okay if I call you Bridget? What does it mean to say I love you? My mother collects the phrase I love you in various languages from strangers in cafes and airports. Phone tucked to my ear, book cradled in my lap. I describe out loud the cedars and the quality of the air, cool, ice flecks. And she says yes, she can already smell it that way. It was said you could persuade Mamuna to return the baby she stole from you if you hit the changeling with a stick and poured water over its head from an eggshell. It was said my mother was evil. This was a lie. The poem must be mess because we love each other. How well my switching lineage, the sliver of Pacific visible in the periphery, my ache when I click the correct number and hear her voice on the other side. Growing up, I could always tell when my mother had recently talked to her mother because her accent would be thicker, want like won't. I am surprised to find this effect still applies, considering my grandmother can no longer speak. For a long time, the only part of my poems anyone praised were the endings. I didn't mind. The way I understood it, if the ending was good, it cast goodness back over the whole. I thought we could be saved at the last minute. In a language neither of us knows, she is telling me she loves me, and I am repeating the sounds back to her, learning. It sounds like the heart trying to leave the chest. Thank you.
Give it up for Gabby Biggs. Wow. Welcome, welcome, come on in. The next reader I'll welcome in this beautiful lineup is Ariana Benson. And Ariana was born in Norfolk, Virginia. Their manuscript, Black Pastoral, was selected by Willie Perdomo as a winner of the 2022 Cave Cannon Poetry Prize. Look out for that book, I cannot wait. A 2022 recipient of the Furious Flower Poetry Prize, Benson's poems also appear or are forthcoming in Poetry Magazine, Plowshares, The Yale Review, Copper Nickel, elsewhere. Through her writing, she strives to fashion vignettes of blackness that speak to its infinite depth and richness. And again, we asked our readers to come up with some words that describe Ariana and her work, and they were spellbinding, piercing, and thorns. Come on. Woo!
I don't know what to do with my hands, my feet, anything. I'm
sitting is working for you.
Yeah, it's a vibe, right? I'm trying to make it a vibe. Okay, so I'm just going to do three poems, and they're all from Black Pastoral. but I was really, I've been inspired so much in my life, but particularly lately by span flowers, but not just actual literal flowers, but still life, like these old, you know, classic by, you know, old white dudes, but these still life portraits of flowers. And so all of these poems will be still life with flowers, and they go from that. And then this piece I'll talk about in a little bit, but this is by Jennifer Packer, a Black woman artist, and it goes with the last poem that I'll read. So I'll just read three poems, and then I'll let other people read, because I'm really just kind of excited to hear everyone read. And thank you again, Joyce and Freddie. I think they're watching over there, but Joyce and Freddie, Seventh Wave, Patrizia, for doing a lovely job stepping in as host at the last minute. All right. So this first poem actually does require a bit of a lead-in story. So in November 2021, I believe, in Durham, North Carolina, there was a little Black boy. He was 6 years old, waiting for the bus stop, sitting at a park bench, like, to get on the bus. And it's outside of this woman's house, and he leans down to pick up a tulip, and the woman calls the police and has the boy arrested for damage to real property. And so a six-year-old boy is sitting in court, not even tall enough that he can see over the top of the table that he's, and his mother couldn't go to court with him. She had to go to work. And so the child is sitting there with this public appointed lawyer that he doesn't know, and she gives him some coloring books, and he starts to color in what I imagine were flowers on the page. So this is about that incident. Still life with tulip as grenade. Each tulip petal is blanketed by its own personal imposter, a doppelganger sepal giving its finest impression of bloom. Aramuris, Phalaenopsis, Hellebore, all haloed at the base by wreaths of colorful leaves. We ourselves are not above playing at majesty when it suits us, when it can be slipped smoothly out of, like a dagger from a too loose sheath. Now, let the scene drain to grisaille. A wrought iron bench, a dull pair of pupils leering through a Queen Anne's lace chalet. The once arabesque garden, now more pastiche of peeling stones suspended. The tulips still longing to know the blushed petal of a rabbit's tongue. The sound embrace of sinew. The boy in monochrome and altered hue, but black all the same. His hand cradling a single gray head, a grenade with only whistle where the pin of green stem used to be. Let's say we're grateful that gunmetal black tulips are rare, that the powder emptied from pistols onto his skin was only pollen. But no, let's not say thank you. We can exhale this snatched gasp corroding our lungs without pretending it's anything more than sick relief. Think now of the boy in the courtroom, seated at a table his eyes have not yet grown to meet, coloring in the scene once more, his fingers dirt brown, raking back and forth across the page. Think of the flowers left in the ground, feigning dead silence, wondering what to do about the imagined problem of black boys who find beauty in all the wrong places. No lead in for this one, I'll just start. Still life with unidentified flora. One. The flowers dying in the vase, the black-eyed Susans and lavender especially, refuse my unrefined pity, sorry in its own right. My stares filter through their dry wisps and catch on the tree in the yard, the one with the severed branch dangling, the dead limb almost as long and full as a boy some would call a man. I am ashamed that I do not know from which kind of tree my mind has just hung that body. That memory that is not a memory of a boy who was never a boy, but a branch the tree will carry until it cannot. The tree would be right not to accept my shame as apology. 2. Above the head-high arm of the jockey on the flower's vase, a whip stretches, curving subtly in the shadow-dimmed porcelain. I spare the horse my sadness at the impending sting of leather on his brown flank. The flowers have taken that sorrow as their own. I am reminded again of what I am inventing. The picture is black and white, so too the horse and his rider. Where else have I found color where it has never grown? 3. The flowers that, for what little I know, could be tick seed and Russian sage, stand firm when I offer one last apology, a pitcher of fresh water. And I consider this, how thin an offering of life when made under the wrong name, transparent as condensation on a pane through which I see another tree, its even smaller boy. I can no less forgive my mind than can a saw forgive its own blade on behalf of what it has unmade. The drops of water on the glass face of the door run fast toward the ground. The limb is cut from the tree's body. The flowers at last shudder and bow. Come on in, join us. Okay, so just one last poem. So I said this already, but this is by Jennifer Packer. She's one of my favorite visual artists, and so much of my work, I think, is inspired by visual art, but this piece in particular is called Say Her Name, and it was painted in honor of Breonna Taylor. And then this poem was written after this painting. And there's an epigraph that reads, "I paint flowers so they will not die. Frida Kahlo." Still life with bouquet, golden spade, out of frame. Oh, you know what? I'm sorry. Pause. I should say something about the form of this. Are we familiar with the golden shovel, at least the Terence Hayes? Okay, so it's that like acrostic form, and it was after Gwendolyn Brooks, and so this form, this poem, is kind of a riff on that. So instead of the through line of "we real cool" going straight down the poem, it goes through diagonally. So you'll maybe hear the echoes of the Brooks and the "we real cool," right? Okay, I'm glad I stopped to say that, I'm sorry. All right. Still life with bouquet, golden spade, out of frame. We be bouquets, be green, leaves ethereal, be wild weeds, be lamb's quarter, be day, flowers, cool blue, be hue busting up, bleak blur. We evening primrose, morning glory, and larkspur, left bent like sunlight through hickory shag bark, schooled in all the ways of the soil, the ways of low dirt. We, the garden and the golden spade used to dig. We, the tiny lurking mantis veiled in verdure, praying under blade. Lately, it seems all there is to do is wait, and wait we will. We outwill winter, bide out the gnaw of blight strikes. We outroot the storm's walled eye, our spine stem straight, sepals unsnapped, petals parted but unshed. We hardy anthurium, philodendron monstera, we sing silky with cordiform, tongues sweating, rosin, we bleed, we bud, we blood, we be bloodied as thorns, we be blushed as trumpet lily, as damask rose, things of beauty, we. We, the bowls, survive the gin, we the clouds in our own sky, the birds too. We be dandelion, be red jasmine, be jazz. We flush just once, like sweet 4 o'clock in June. Buds unfist for a 4 days bloom. We hear sorry swoons. How lovely, how quick they die, die so soon. Thank you. Thank you.
Yep, it's on.
Give it up for Ariana. Woohoo! Our next reader is Sara Ghazal Ali, who is the author of Theophanies, selected as the editor's choice for the 2022 Alice James Award, forthcoming with Alice James Books in January 2024. So, woo! Keep an eye out. This lineup just makes me so happy because it is full of beautiful poets whose books are either like just out, about to come out, or like just wait, they're coming. So I'm really excited about all the beautiful poets here. So Sara's poems appear in Poetry, American Poetry Review, Pleiades, The Rumpus, elsewhere. She's currently a Stadler Fellow at Bucknell University and an associate editor from West Branch. We asked our readers to come up with some words that describe Sara and her work, and they were brilliant, unflinching, resistant, hourglass. Come on up. Woo!
Thank you so much for having me. Thanks to the folks here for welcoming us into this beautiful, beautiful space. Thanks to Joyce and Brady over here, who I wish could be here. Honestly, when I think community, the first thing that comes to mind is the Seventh Wave, so it feels so special to be here reading with six other brilliant poets. Thank you. Okay, oh, now I can hear myself. Also, my foot is numb, so I'm just kidding.
Give me 1 second.
So don't fall. Okay, I'm good. I'll read three poems as well. I'll read two from my forthcoming book and then one brand new poem because I'm feeling fun and yeah. So this first poem, I guess all you really need to know is I'm really into God and I'm really into scripture and stuff like that. So this poem is about a dead goat. It's called Eid al-Adha. That you have already killed a blindfolded goat, stroked its fur as it bled against your jeans. Were I to touch warm blood, eyes closed, I'd think it my own. Your dry hands over mine, urging me to follow my dreams, my throat hitching carily around the pill of permission. A tale as reliant on who tells as who listens, on the temperament attributed to each's God. One version, Ibrahim was commanded, so obliged, so rewarded with the goat, a substitute sacrifice. Another, he woke from a dream, divined it a sign. I don't claim to know which son, but believe he nodded, insisted, you must. His eyes closed, his hand tightening around his father's, pulling the blade toward himself. Must I keep seeing these rites my father forbade? The dream roiling turbid through me a dream calving limbs speaking. That you sat holding its cooling body, whispering 99 names to soothe until it stilled. The angle of the knife capable of precluding pain. That I believe this, and you, holding close the exegeses of fallible men. This next poem is called Sarai, which according to some traditions was Sarah's name before God changed it to Sara. A name is not unlike a sexed body. Like mine, it carries, is remembered most for what it fails to yield. A name is a condition meant to last, to outlast, as should a daughter, her mother tongue. I am but do not have a daughter. When I look in the lake, Who looks back is a sister self. Oh, little I carry you as you carry who I'm waiting to be.
Thank you.
And in like post theophanies, more recent, ugly, horrific experiments, I'm really interested in, I don't even know, surveillance and the image and who looks at who and what we look at and what we do with what we look at. So this is a bizarre poem that is trying to think about images a little bit. This is Thou Shalt Not Make Unto Thee. Tapering April, coat cold no longer. The dogwoods could be abloom but aren't. Against my cheek, ghost pipes erupt as if eager, as if straining to catch what flees my eyes, to soak instead the soft Georgia humus. To keep living, I must ask and endlessly listen. For what? I'm not naive enough to still believe the answer, the fiction that arrives insistent. Yet the word clangs like a bell against my brow. Voice. Whose do I molder for? Long those childhood nights passed scratching the drywall, begging for anyone to push through and touch me. Might I but more tonight in you whose name I eschew? Long have I loved the graven image I've hewed of you. Thank you. I'm actually gonna read 9 more poems, so, no, just kidding. I'm gonna introduce our next reader, the wonderful Patrizia Hrumenik. Dear, dear, beloved, wonderful Patrizia Hrumenik, daughter of Polish immigrants, is a writer, editor, and performance artist based in Seattle, Washington. Her poetry is featured or forthcoming in Gulf Coast, Tri-Quarterly, 128 Lit, Ninth Letter, The Adroit Journal, Sand Journal Berlin, ooh, fancy, Hayden's Ferry Review, The Slowdown Show, The Beautiful Podcast, and elsewhere. She has collaboratively developed performance work for Tit Wrench Festival, Gay City Seattle, Red Cat New Original Works Festival, Film on the Rocks at Red Rocks Amphitheater, and Deco Literary Series. Patrizia is working on her first book, Anchor Baby. We asked our readers to come up with some words that describe Patrizia and her work, and they were courageous, expansive, heartrending, sinuous, bridge. These last words are like, very tactile. Yes, welcome, Patrizia.
Thank you so much. Feels right to start with a poem that's from a series called Letter to Another Immigrant Daughter, that's for Sarah. So I'll kick it off with that one. I'm just so happy to be reading with you all. This is so cute. This actually, I'm gonna take a picture of this cute audience, if that's okay with you guys. Jeez. All right. Letter to Another Immigrant Daughter, for Sarah. Days unclear, filled with sun, the flicker of another life coming for me, rushing, makes an imprint. Bruised knees, time purpling the rhododendron. Near summer, when childhood's shadow is near, you say you feel God's hand. Where on your back exactly? In my earliest memory, my father is teaching me on the couch in a small apartment how to make the sign of the cross. Mama observes a birthmark the shape of Polska on her forearm, meant for a better story. I wish for kinder eyes to see less of everything. Sometimes I go walking without my glasses. Maybe next time I'll spin in the grass, arms wide open. I hope I'm laughing when I fall. I want to send that laughter to you.
I wear contacts now, which is, has changed my life, but, you know. I'll read a couple more. This next poem is after Elisa Gonzalez, who's a brilliant poet who has a forthcoming stunning book called Grand Tour that you should look out for. And that book has some poems called Failed Essay on. So this poem borrows from that conceit. Failed essay on repressed sexuality. The internet was my childhood refuge. It's where I practice still, erase my browsing history. At the strip club, a friend leans over to say the search for a moral politic is a failure. How it mirrors a religious pursuit, that fervor. I agree, then disagree. I'm watching my favorite dancer, feeling the ghost of my teenage body, a river rushing superimposed boundaries. Do to me what sunlight does to a river.
Come on.
All right, I'll read one more, and this is the title poem from, come on in, welcome. This is the title poem from my manuscript in progress, Anchor Baby. I keep close the intonation of my name, spoken in my mother's voice. There was a time I let people mispronounce it. I don't remember the sound of my grandfather's voice. I've lost the word for the flower I could be, impatient blossom. Used to never wear lipstick. Now I smear shades of azalea on my lips. I kiss everything. I leave a mark. Invocation, as in a prayer I want to repeat. The physicality of it. Prayer, kissing, echoes of a younger me, trying to be approved of. I'm not saying I am better now. I look up how to say anchor in my first language, once I didn't need to search. Kotfitsa, my mama gave birth to me a month after my parents arrived in the States. Nie mówiła wtedy po polsku. It was her first time on a plane. I know nothing of ground, of letting the ship sleep. I fly for hours to visit. If I could bind myself to a place, put cut flowers in a vase, I would thank my mother that way. Instead, I pour the petals out. Thank you. All right, I'm so excited to welcome our next reader, Troy Osaki. Right around, yep, no. Troy is the grandson of Filipino immigrants and the great-grandson of Japanese immigrants, a poet, organizer, and attorney. Osaki is a three-time Grand Slam poetry champion and has earned fellowships from Kundiman, Hugo House, and Jack Straw Cultural Center. He was awarded a Ruth Lilly and Dorothy Sargent Rosenberg Poetry Fellowship from the Poetry Foundation in 2022. A critic at large for Poetry Northwest, his poetry has appeared in Crazy Horse, The Margins, Muzzle Magazine, Tinderbox Poetry Journal, and elsewhere. He holds a Juris Doctor degree from the Seattle University School of Law, where he interned at Creative Justice, an arts-based alternative to incarceration for youth in King County. He lives in Seattle, Washington. The words that we came up with to describe Troy and his work were inspiring, arresting, daring, and sharp-eyed. Thank you, Troy.
If you've heard something that's moved you, can you make some noise? Yeah. Dope. I'd like to share the lines that really moved me. This was wild, and there's still more to come. Okay, it starts with, where did the angel come from? The ground. Fuck, that was so good. Okay, unswum pools, the sliver of the Pacific, snatched gas, that memory that's not a memory. We be blush as trumpet lily, whispering 99 names until it stills. When I look into the lake, what looks back is a sister self. Ghost pipes erupt. I wish for kinder eyes. Do to me what sunlight does to a river. I know nothing of the ground. Can we give it up for all the readers so far? Okay. Thank you. My name's Troy. I'm gonna do three poems. I like this little three situation. Okay. A sneak peek. All of them are gonna be about the Philippines. So shout out any Filipinos in the room, or shout out your Filipino homies. This first poem is after another Filipino author, Matthew Olsman. He has a really wonderful poem that has stuck with me over the years. It's a love poem and like disguised as a Mountain Dew commercial, which I found out through Gabby's Hugo House class is dedicated to his wife, who's a wonderful, incredible poet, Vivi Francis. Give it up for Vivi Francis. I wanted to write after I heard that, and it's for my beloved. We hit 9 years last month, so it's titled My Beloved. A mass leader cleans our turtle tank at 10 p.m. after Matthew Olsman. Here's what I've got. The reason why I call you my comrade. Because you wear your Lola's sweatpants and fly to New York to yell in President Marcos's face. Because you chant at rallies loudly and almost never lose your voice. Because you can hold a megaphone, march 5 miles. Because you memorize protest songs from the Philippines and know how to say fascist and people's war in Tagalog. You want to live in collective housing. Because when our mass organization elected you chairperson after our last chairperson was tagged a terrorist, you boiled pork bone in a pot, listened to its steam, and accepted. Because you think career aspirations are overrated. It is so true. Because you want to raise a proletarian family. You want to name our children after our martyrs. Because you underline the author's nom de guerre in Philippine society and revolution. Amado, or beloved. Because when we returned to the countryside, to rice fields and taro plants, your skin cleared up, and so did mine. Because the year your dad died, you told me it wasn't the worst year you ever lived, and asked instead, how could it be if the mass movement was growing? And years ago, before our first lightning rally, when your dad gifted you 3 turtles while you were in college, and before your landlord at the apartment behind Chipotle on the Ave told you to get rid of them, you invited me to see them after class one spring day, when the quad overflowed with cherry blossoms. And when I walked into your bedroom, you dipped your fingers into the 10-gallon tank, lifted out a turtle you named Gilbert, and asked if I wanted to hold him, to which I nodded. And have since remembered the retro wood flooring beneath us, the set of Forever 21 rings scattered across your dresser, the sun warm water dripping from the shell, and most of all, when you cupped my palms with your own and set down your turtle. That was the first time our hands ever touched. Okay. Thank you. So these are some photos of the Philippines that I got to take. Very beautiful, very lush. And then I think there's like one more that was showing earlier. So this next piece is a piece that I wrote just with the Philippines in mind. I was at an anti-human trafficking conference, and something that someone said there really stuck with me, which was every Filipino belongs to the Philippine nation, meaning even if you're an overseas Filipino, you still belong to the Philippines and are part of the same struggle for a homeland that still needs to work towards being like a sovereign nation and have industries in its own country for people to be able to make a livelihood and not have to seek work outside of the Philippines. I kept that idea in mind. This photo right here is a photo of an area called Hacienda Luisita. It's a farm where farmers had to occupy the farm, even though they weren't allowed to be on it, in order to grow food to be able to live. They took the farm and started using it. And it was a very wonderful act of resistance. But this is every Filipino belongs to the Philippines. All of us, everywhere. The fry cook at Jollibee in South Center Mall. The grocery bagger at Seafood City next door. The custodian mopping the floor in Suzalo or Odegaard at the University of Washington. The caregiver unfolding a wheelchair in Linwood, the cashier at Goodwill off Dearborn, the ground crew at SeaTac Airport, the child care provider driving a minivan on a Navy base in Oak Harbor or Bremerton or Silverdale, the housekeeper at Swedish Hospital, the seafarer docked in Portland or Tacoma or floating in the Pacific, his face cold enough almost to disappear. Everywhere our people are overseas is a place we want our people back from. Apartments, hotel rooms, homestays, everywhere our people package a pear inside a bullock buy-in box, wedge it between instant coffee and bars of soap, a whole church bell and cans of Spam too. Everywhere our people mail a million envelopes of remittances from, stamps stuck crookedly to the corner of each one. Everywhere our people's employers lock their passports away in a private safe, their monthly earnings stolen, debt the size of shipping containers. Everywhere our people are trafficked. We want them back, and we want a country to come home to. Okay, last poem. Thank you so much, Seventh Wave. Thank you, Cam. Thank you to all the readers tonight. Just very grateful to end like AWP with you all. This is my first AWP, and it was like very sweet. There's so many cool people, and just very grateful to be here with you all. This last poem is after it was the first guzzle I wrote, and I was very inspired by Natasha Trethewey. So please check out Natasha Trethewey if you haven't already. And it's called Despedida for the Last Despedida. Despedida translates loosely to like a goodbye party. And so the idea is to have a goodbye party for the last goodbye party for Filipinos so that they don't ever have to leave the Philippines if they don't want to. So Despedida for the Last Despedida after Natasha Trethewey. In the Philippines, we abolish goodbye parties for Filipinos who don't want to leave. Become overseas Filipinos. Every colonizer wants to be remembered. See our country whose name is a Spanish king's name, Philip and Filipino. The smell of mined dirt is gone. Chevron swims back to America weeping, and we watch laughing, us Filipinos. In a monsoon, we bring Andres Bonifacio's glowing bones to a sugar plantation. There, an army of peasant Filipinos, their first 53 years spent lovingly, burying piles of landlords. Every bloomed mango belongs to a farming Filipino. My grandpa left and didn't come back. Years later, I lay in the river he washed in, my body like his Filipino. His last name is my middle name, Verzosa, Spanish, as am I, and millions of breathing Filipinos. Thank you all so much.
Give it up for those poems and that co-host energy, that stitched together poem. That was so beautiful. That was beautiful. Our next reader, among again, everyone here, I'm just in love with their poems and them as a person, so I just feel so lucky to introduce everybody. And the next person is Erin Marie Lynch, who is the author of Removal Act, forthcoming from Grey Wolf Press in 2023 this year. So look out for that Removal Act. Her writing appears in New England Review, Gulf Coast, Diagram, Best New Poets, and elsewhere, a winner of Narrative Magazine's 30 Below contest. She has been the recipient of an NEA Fellowship and a Hugo House Fellowship. Currently, she is a PhD candidate in creative writing and literature at the University of Southern California, where she serves as the managing editor of Ricochet Editions. We asked our readers to come up with those words, so the words for Erin and her work were ethereal, sweeping, capacious, axe, and hot genius. Come on up, Erin!
Might be good for the live stream if people are watching.
Oh yeah, for sure then, no worries. Let's get it up. I can take my shoes off too. Yeah, have options. Thank you, okay, perfect. Thank you. Seventh Wave really is just a very intentional and relational organization, and they're always so careful and considered the way they do things, and this space is really amazing. I can't believe I lived here for like 6 years. I never knew about this, so the more you know. This poem is called St. Helens. I came when called, polished silverware with blue paste, saw myself in the mirror, then turned away, thinking, seeing herself naked, she turned away. Soaked my blood-stained underwear in the sink, sat silent at church like moss on a car hood. Shut the shoebox that held a long, dark braid severed a century ago by a butcher knife. Waded the culvert down to where it fled. Read about the vanishing hitchhiker who appears in the back seat, whispers, St. Helens will erupt in May. Let shadows in my closet press closely, hissing, show us your ugly heart, lift up your shirt. Wondered if ghosts chose to be. Lay on my back under the apple tree. Felt the neighbor's shape fall across me as he said, nothing like a pretty girl reading. Was allowed by distance to hide the volcano, small and cold, with my hand. Can I get the image on the screen? Okay, cool. So my book is called Removal Acts, and obviously there was a whole series of legal measures of removal for Indian nations and tribes that were all removal acts. The specific one in my book is the 1863 Dakota Removal Act that removed the Dakota nations and tribes from Minnesota. And then it's still in effect today. It's actually illegal to be Dakota in Minnesota. Every few years they bring it to the state legislature and they're like, someone says we should abolish this law. And they're like, not a priority. And then it just stays as it was. But I am interested in that idea of a removal act and different ways that that might manifest. So this poem that I don't think you can see the whole thing, but that's okay, because you can see the kind of cutout, is about a photo that's owned by the British Museum, thank you, that I wasn't able to put in my book because it's illegal for me to do so. Okay. Removal Act, and this is the form it takes in the book. Many of the households in my family keep a portrait of Mato Sabisea, my grandfather's grandfather, great, great, great. We find this portrait on the website of the museum that has acquired the original. Acquisition notes. Photographs of North American Indians and miscellanea given to the Department of Ceramics and Ethnography. Given. We screenshot the image, print it with shitty inkjets, then cut the paper into smaller rectangles measured to fit dollar store picture frames. The original photo was taken in Washington, D.C., capital of the ever-expanding American Empire. In my grandfather's telling, Mato Sabisea had traveled there to discuss treaty terms. Department, Africa, Oceania, and the Americas. Of all the chiefs of the Oyate, he'd held out longest. They, always they, in my grandfather's telling, rode Mato Sabisea into the Atlantic, his first time seeing that ocean. Location, not on display. Oars pushing back waves, they gave a choice. Sign the treaty or go overboard. He signed, fingers shaking, ink mixed with salt spray, streaking down parchment. Registration number AMA39.23. Here, in low res black and white, he holds his pipe, blanket over knees, gaze fixed to his right, my left. Technique, albumen printing. Up close, I feel a living distance between my forehead and his forehead. Up close, creases under his eyes, hooked arc of his nose, his broad upper lip, all dissolve into ink dots. Asset number 64509001. Each dot a droplet, each dot void, each dot sovereign. The opposite of diminishment. Countless dots make up the face of the grandfather we place in every home. I have two more. I'm reading four.
Crazy!
But they're little. They're just little. This is called Thing with Feathers. Celibacy, the name I call myself right as the birds wake. No, what birds? No birds, but now I open the blinds, flies, large and silent. I'm so dulled, enfolded in the dread of being real only to myself. The flies on the window won't move. Mom on speakerphone. One of the chickens got the taste for its own eggs. Whose voice but mine interjects as I smash the flies with a hard back, one by one? Poor bird, poor bird. They splay open, yellow inside. The book is by Zeed Kala Saw. Just hit me, I said once to a man, then struck my own cheek hard, felt myself warp and shrink. Before this peculiar experience, I have no distinct memory of having recognized any vital bond between myself and my own shadow, wrote Zeed Kala Saw. Oh, doubled form that no longer owns me. I fold into a paper towel remains of these. Poor birds. What birds? Surely at some point, my mind will cease reviving indignities. When the TSA agent slipped her fingers inside my waistband, moved slowly over my hip bones, the small of my back, my waist, my stomach, resting for a moment below my belly button, my gaze turned out and back onto my body, despite myself, turned on. And this is another poem called Removal Act. All the while, the dog was dying. I didn't know. His little heaps of yellow vomit, damp spots where he'd slept. I didn't know what it meant until meaning sat still enough for me to see nothing else. Then a man put in my hand a pamphlet on loss. Big flat letters, a sun rising or setting above gray waves, the clouds arrayed in shapes incomparable to any animal. I thanked him, shut the door. For a long time, I lay quiet on the floor. Unneeded, I had no meaning, or meaning unmade itself, no longer needing me.
Sheesh, oh my gosh. Our last reader closing us out is Sadia Hassan, who is the author of Enumeration with Akashic Press and an award-winning writer and storytelling consultant from Atlanta, winner of the 2021 Georgia Review SoPoco Fellowship, the 2020 Hurston Wright College Writers Award, and 2019 finalist for the Krauss Essay Prize, interdisciplinary, hello. Hassan is currently working on a collection of poems about archives and women prophets. You can find more.
Amazing to have all of this art and be surrounded by it as we're reading. But yeah, speaking of sisters, the first poem I'm actually gonna read is a poem I wrote thinking about my sisters and all of my sister cousins and my big sister, who's on the live stream right now, is the reason that like I really got into writing. She was the first writer that I knew, and she's the reason Seattle feels like home to me, so. Yeah, so self-portrait with cumin, saffron, and star anise. After Safia Elgio. I pledge allegiance to sisters, to the wild squeal of a secret over telephone wires, the long stare between head tilt and cackle, lipstick on the hem of a skirt, gym shorts souring the sheets, earbuds mixed up good with the keys and the cards in the underwear drawer. And to the underwear drawer, which is now a makeup drawer. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the superior wrist flick, the tender tremble of an eyelash upon ink dressing, thumb licked and charmed against slips, dips, or worse, a dash too blunt for the crease. And to the smooth stroke after, I pledge an allegiance of color. Glazed sugar, cabaret, gold gleam, blunt in the bathroom to smoke up the street, rustle of coats, clamor of boots, hush of palms, hustling heat from wintry air. to cumin, saffron, and star anise, sisters of the roasted goat and rice ritual, daughters of smoke and gossip, glowing and blood warm, allegiant to nothing but the fan's whirling dervish, I pledge allegiance to the pleasure of what needs doing after. This next poem is called Record of Devotion. What animosity do you hold against? That he gave you a mother, or that he gave you a mother who herself had a mother? Is there anything more perfect in this world than not even your grief, though it laps at your feet unblemished? Have you worried the shadow, being true to its form, submits too soon to light? Do you trust it submits of its own volition? To whom do you submit? Of what is your volition? Have you a partiality to light or shame that you cannot, though you petition, unfeel the terror of being? This is gonna go by real quick. Anti-elegy. My swimmer's body a slash at the door. I listen to you thrash against the shore of sleep. I think we owe this to each other, to never dream alone again, to come home when asked. You would say, I want for you the world, its favors. But the world is ending, its favors few. I want for us a future no longer wrecked against the animal love made of us. Plenty animals eat their young. Plenty destroy their nest out of impatience. This too we owe the other. To mother now, in this new language, sit, watch the movie of our lives without sound, scalps itching at the sight of so much teeth, so little fat. Other girls are allowed their mothers in a lexicon sacred to them both, but I am not other girls. Not even a girl, not little or yours when angry. I want to say I bore witness to the world when it failed you. I tried, I didn't, not really. I held my hand out, shielding only my face from the sun. The most American disease is the disease of self-obsession. In its ruins, I find there are questions I never quite learned to ask. How can I help? What did you need? How will I know? And this poem is about summer in Mississippi. That place holds a big and dear place in my heart. I'm not from Mississippi, I'm from Atlanta, but fuck Georgia. Mississippi though. That's ridiculous, okay. Mississippi summers. Nothing quiet about summer in Mississippi. The chorus of crickets, bullfrogs, horse flies so loud you can barely think. It's like coming to a gospel trying to outsing the God spark of a creek's babble. It is disrespectful. I am learning I wither in winters. I miss the sigh and squelch of certain possums rooting for snails in the heat sweet of night. Also this, stillness, a column of air which never trembles. It is the engine of memory which causes me grief. Where I resist, I know I won't submit. I know I fear death too much, thinking winter is the black of his eyes when it is only the cover pulled tight. What survives, survives, though not everyone lives to hear it. This dirge, this honey-sweet echo, gulf, muley grass, sashaying, pretending its tips my tresses, this starburst pink, this setting sun, thin as a silver dollar, and the blood-good maple still guarding the meadow, Appaloosas. Appaloosas trampling the jewelweed, unable to hold back their weight, dear God, the light. Duckweed set like lanterns along the river's edge, convinced like I am convinced. If we blink, we can be forgiven for what we could not hold off, the wind, the geese, the piping plover in flight, dear God, the light. Let it pour through me as a sieve. Thank you.
Thank you so much, everybody, for coming. Give it up for these readers. I feel so lucky. Incredible. Thank you, Joyce and Freddy, everything you do with the Seventh Wave to make this possible. Thank you for everyone turning out. I know I'll be reading all of these poets for the rest of my life, so I feel so lucky to, not to be dramatic, but it's true. I feel so lucky to read alongside them. Hang out if you want. There are books to buy. There's some drinks, support Cam. Say hello to us and or go where you're going next, but thanks for spending some AWP time with us. Thank you.